So, without further ado, Sarah, would you like to talk about the ECE strike?
Yes, most of you will probably know me as UCU's communications officer, but you may well know that our key officers are currently in Buenos Aires on a very nice month-long holiday. And given everything that's been going on at the minute, they have left me in charge, which was perhaps not their wisest decision. So I'm currently president of UCU, but UCU is a massive branch, so there's just so many of us that you'll see me around quite a lot of it. So I was going to talk to you all about the current USS strikes that are going on, and I thought that I'd give a bit of context about that and talk a little bit about what we actually did to achieve what we've done. But then also, since the topic is women in sort of strike and on strike and women in the trade union movement, I thought I'd give you a few anecdotes from the recent strikes about how it's still different being a woman on strike. It's incredible. You'd have thought by now that it would be all equal and everything, but even nowadays being a woman on strike is sometimes a very different experience, I think, so I thought I'd mention a couple of those things. So I'm a university researcher, I am not a university lecturer, so I should make clear from the start that the media always advertise this as being a lecturer's strike, and it's not a lecturer's strike. Lecturers are one of the professions that UCU represent, but they also represent professional services, librarians, technicians, and people like me who are researchers. Now, researchers have the joy of being on the most precarious and unsafe contracts that exist probably in higher education. So I've been working at the University of Leicester for nearly 9 years, and over that time I've probably had 5 different contracts, and I've worked on 5 different projects, and I spend the vast majority of my working life making sure that I've got money to pay for my salary next year, which is an absolute waste of time in my opinion, and means that I can't actually get on with my job, which is to be a researcher. I'm not paid to teach, but I do teach, because I believe it's important to contribute towards higher education, and because one day I would like an academic post, and the way that they sort of offer this to me is by saying, if you do some teaching for us for free, then maybe one day we'll give you an academic post, and if you do this qualification in teaching, well, maybe one day. Anyway, this has been going on for 9 years now, so I don't think it's going to happen anytime soon, but this is just to explain the context of where I'm coming from. I'm not a lecturer, I'm a research associate, I'm a statistician in medicine. So just to give you a bit of background to where we're at, I mean, things have been not great in the higher education system, as I'm sure you're all aware, for quite a long time. But the reason why this strike has been so big and so important, I think, is because of the way we've been treated over particularly the last 10 years since I've been in higher education. So for the last 10 years, we've had our salaries increased by about 1% each year. We've striked a couple of times in the past to try and get a bit more. I think we've managed to get them up to a 1.2% increase, but we've never really gotten much higher than that. So we're seeing our salaries more or less frozen, or falling actually in real terms. And we're seeing at the same time though, the leaderships of universities, the vice chancellors and the leadership teams earning more and more than ever before. Now, I don't know if any of you saw Channel 4 did a dispatches programme about the ridiculous expense claims put in by university senior members of staff and claiming for extraordinary things, porn star martinis, 5-star hotels, first class flights. Meanwhile, I'm allowed to claim £30 for a meal when I'm away with work, but they'll make it as hard as possible for me to make that claim. The last time I went abroad to within Europe, I had to provide the conversion rate of the euro at the time that I bought the meal, not the conversion rate generally. So they make it as difficult as possible for us. So it's all a very hypocritical system. The staff like me, the younger members of higher education staff, are also the first people leaving university with large debt. I won't say massive debt, I only graduated with £25,000 worth of debt, which in comparison to what students now are graduating with is a drop in the ocean. Many of them are graduating with £50,000 plus. So I graduated with £25,000, I only borrowed £18,000, so the rest had just sort of accumulated out of control over the years that I was at university from interest. So I've got that massive debt, which after 10 years I still owe £22,000, so I'm not clearing this debt at all, but I'm paying a large amount back to student loans every year. Within the last 5 years, we lost the final salary scheme pension that we had, which was a very nice pension scheme, I'm not denying that, and lots of other people have lost them, but we lost that, and then we went on to have another knock of our pension scheme recently. And the thing is that for us in the university sector, a lot of us have the opportunity to work in the private sector. So I could go work for AstraZeneca or some big pharmaceutical company. I could earn easily twice what I earn now, but I choose not to because I believe that there is a good in working in higher education and working in the public sector. And therefore, really, the decent pensions we were getting was kind of the reward we were getting for staying in the public sector rather than going to the private sector, where we would earn easily twice as much. So we're all faced with this conflict of, do I leave and go somewhere else that I know will pay me better at least? And so in the last few years, we've had a lot of problems when it's come to strike action. We tried a few years back, some of you will remember, we did 2-hour walkouts rather than all day, and our employers deducted us a whole day's salary, even though we were only out of work for 2 hours. So we tried doing sort of symbolic strikes, and that didn't work very well. And in Leicester, we generally weren't very good. I'll admit that now, as a Leicester UCU member, our picket lines were not well attended and not well supported. I think what probably really changed was the introduction of the Trade Union Act, perhaps made a lot of people very angry. So we're probably the first major strike that I'm aware of that's had to meet these archaic new laws from the Trade Union Act. And so now we have to achieve a turnout of at least 50% of our members in a ballot to be able to strike. And so we had to run this absolutely massive campaign at Leicester to even get people to vote about taking part in the strike action. So Leicester, we ran this massive campaign called Get the Vote Out, and campaigned really hard. We got our membership increased from about 700 people to about 850 over the sort of the last 6 months or so whilst we've been doing this. And we were very proud that we actually got the sixth highest turnout in the country. We had a turnout of about 60% of our members, of which a good 85-90% voted in favour of the strike action. So I was very pleased with that. It was exhausting, but well worth it. And so, as you all know, we've been out on strike. We decided that actually one day strikes here or there, we're not going to cut it this time, and that the best way to get our employers' attention was to walk out for 14 days, which we did. We did it sort of in a staggering, sort of we did 2 days one day week, then 3 days the next, then four, then five, which is actually a good way of doing it, because striking is exhausting, and actually it's a good way to build yourself up to it. It's not simply standing on picket lines, getting snowed on and everything else. On the first day of the strike action, I suspect many of you were there, but We marched up to Field and Johnson at the end of our picket line, probably about 150 members that had been picketing, and we acquire a lot of other people when we march up to Field and Johnson. And there was the students also decided to do a solidarity protest of saying they'd rather be in lectures, but actually they were supporting us. The university seriously misjudged the situation. The university sent the Security Act to protect UCU, because they thought that the students were protesting against us about their loss of lectures. They didn't understand that the students were with us. I think that was the point at which the university realised that they had seriously misjudged this whole situation. And after that, there's been quite a lot of climbing down locally by universities. Now, some of you will remember we had a deal put to us about halfway through the strike action by Universities UK and UCU, which they'd negotiated together. Leicester, we more or less unanimously rejected it. It was not even worth wasting our time looking at it, to be honest. And some of you would have seen the photographs, the 141 taken by Steve, of us all voting on Victoria Park, because we had 12 hours to get a response back to UCU, and we didn't have the time to book a meeting room. So on a very cold morning, we stood on Victoria Park and had an open meeting and took our vote there. Just to give a couple of examples, I said I'd give a couple of examples of being a woman on strike. Because I'm quite a senior officer within UCU, I was asked whether I would go to University Senate as part of the, we were putting a motion together, the university and the union together, to say that they encourage the resuming of negotiations, and we spent a long time working out this motion together. When I got to Field and Johnson as the UCU representative, I was supposed to be going in with Paul Brook, for those of you who know him, our secretary. And when I got there, Field and Johnson was in lockdown. I think they were worried about students getting in and occupying again. I was locked out of Field and Johnson. Some of you will have been there on this day. And not only that, but they locked me out with five heads of department and wouldn't allow any of us in. And they realised they'd made a mistake when they went to start Senate and realised that there was no union officer in there, because the union officer was locked outside. And they did let the heads of the departments in, but then they refused to allow me entry into Senate. And the problem is, I'm a gobby so-and-so a lot of the time, but a lot of the time I just want a quiet life. And I think this is probably a trait of being a woman slightly. I'm not saying women are all meek and everything, but I think sometimes we'll back down a bit easier. And Senna said to me, you're not coming in. Your name's not on the guest list. You're not welcome. And I just went, oh, well, okay, that's fine then. If I'm not on the guest list, then obviously I can't come in. Whereas the secretary of my branch refused point blank. He said, I'm not going in unless Sarah comes in with me. And so we waited and waited, and Senate eventually realised that they couldn't start without us being in there. So they had to let me in. And walking into that room is one of the strangest experiences of my life, because I was dressed in my picket line attire, which is similar to this but includes another 10 layers of clothes. And on top I had my University of Wales hoodie on, and as I walked in, all these upper class white men in suits and ties look at me and go, oh dear God, where's she come from? So it was an interesting experience of my life. And just to quickly mention International Women's Day as well on the strike line, which some of you will have seen, particularly Ambrose's wonderful coverage of. The University of Leicester has one building named after a woman, and that's the Danielle Brown Sports Centre, named after a wonderful Paralympian who studied at the University of Leicester. Other than that, we have absolutely nothing at all. We've made many suggestions over the years, and recently my department sent me a list of vacant buildings, which if I wanted to, I could offer a woman's name for. But we don't have any at all, so we spent International Women's Day renaming the buildings with temporary cardboard figures, although one or two of them are still up. So perhaps the people who actually work in those buildings approve of the decisions we made of how to rename the buildings. So I'll just finish off by saying where we're at now. So as you'll know, there's now been a second offer put to us. This is now that together the UCU and the UUK will form a collaborative party to look at evaluation of our pensions. What's annoyed us a little bit now is probably internal union politics, so I won't go on about it too much, but it's now a ballot has been put to our members about whether or not they want to accept the new deal. Many of us feel that it's not the time to put it to members because we don't feel like it's good enough yet, but we're in that position now and it's going to go to members. So that will be the next week or two, so keep an eye out for that. And I think Leicester UCU will be making a decision over the next few days about whether we're going to campaign, vote no, vote yes, or just boycott the ballot, or what we're going to do. Locally though, we've had some good wins. Our university's offered to spread out our strike pay 2 days a month until we finish paying it back. So if we do the full 28 days of strike, it's going to take us well over a year to pay the university back. They've given us money back that we're owed from strikes in 2014 and 2012, so they deducted our salaries at 1/260th, but legislation's changed recently, and you're supposed to deduct 1/365th, so we're getting the difference back. So actually, I think my first day or first 2 days out on strike, I won't suffer at all, so that's quite nice. Bizarrely, they've also offered interest-free loans to staff who can't afford to pay the bills as a result of the strike action, but I'm not quite sure what that offer was about. And as many of you will be aware, they've said that actually our salaries are going to go to the student hardship funds. I should say that was not a decision of our Vice-Chancellor. When I put to him outside Field and Johnson, what are you going to do with my salary, he looked panicked at his head of HR and his the registrar, who whispered in his ear, perhaps you should give it to student hardship. So it's not even a nice thing from him, I'm afraid. That's from one of the administrators of the university. So that's where we're at now. I'll stop there. I'm happy to take questions now or later, or you can come grab me and talk to it. But hopefully that'll give you an overview. Pensions are not a very exciting topic. However, this is about more than pensions. This is about the future of higher education. They bought this on themselves by making a consumer market of higher education by charging such ridiculous fees for students. And actually all we want is what we consider to be our rightful pay. It might be our pay received in retirement, or it might be our pay received now, but we think we should be fairly paid. Given all that context of everything else that's going on.